Good morning, friends. I'm Srishti Jain, and today we are going to discuss 5 questions of finance. So today, the questions that we are going to discuss are really important, related to the private equity funds and its comparison with other kinds of funds. Then we have the news on Insurance and Development Authority of India. So we are going to discuss that as well through a question. Then some changes made by RBI and the National Equity Fund Scheme. So stay tuned till the end of the video. If you like my video, then do subscribe to our channel for more regular updates. Now, starting with the first question for today. The question says, XYZ Limited is a private company working from past 5 years. Recently, it witnessed that it is unable to meet its expenses and is caught in financial difficulty. Which of the following could help XYZ company to come out of this financial difficulty? Now, 4 kind of funds have been given to you. Now, we will be discussing the aim of each and every funds here in the next slide. So, do listen to this part very carefully. The first is the private equity funds. Now, what is private equity funds? Now, private equity firms invest when a company has gone beyond generating revenue and develop profitable margins, stable cash flow, and is able to service a significant amount of debt. So when this firm sees that a particular company is financially distressed, then what happens? This firm tries to help the struggling firm and thereby help that firm to revive. In order to do so, it cuts the operational expenses, so the employees may be fired as to bring the operational cost down. Now, for example, if this private equity fund sees 3 struggling firms, but it does not have enough money to invest in these 3 companies so as to revive them, so as to make them again profitable. So what it does is, it invests in all of the 3 companies proportionately or in whatsoever manner it wishes to, so that these 3 companies are now capable to borrow itself from the market. So the basic aim of private equity funds is to improve the financially distressed companies into the profitable companies. And when the need arises, what happens is they exit from this. Now we have the hedge funds. So what are hedge funds? They are highly risky. Why? Because they are highly levered firm. So they borrow more than their capacity, and that is why they are highly risky. So this is large investors are involved here, but in small numbers. This means that only the wealthy individuals are involved in the hedge funds. So therefore, their number is small. And what they do is, they generally invest in the liquid assets so as to meet their interest payments. And as small number of investors are involved, so what happens is, they are not regulated as mutual funds where stake of large number of investors is involved. Now we have the venture capitalist and angel funds. So both of these invest in startups. But then one question comes to mind, that what is the difference between angel funds and venture capitalist? So these angel funds invest and enter in the pre-revenue stage of the business, that is in the seed funding stage or the budding stage of an enterprise. Whereas if we talk about venture capitalist, when the startup begins to grow and the venture capitalist finds that this startup has some prospects for future growth and it can be successful in the future time, so there comes the role of venture capitalist. Angel funds, on the other hand, invest if the angel investor sees some attachment to the entrepreneur of startup or to the activities it is performing. So angel funds and venture capitalists, both are for the startups, but their time of entry is therefore different. So for example, a venture capitalist may invest in 10 startups, hoping that if 8 or 9 startups fail, then at least one startup succeed and become successful so as to compensate for the failure for the investment in the 10 startups. Now, moving back to the question, it says that XYZ company was in a financial difficulty. So, as per the discussion we had, which among these will help XYZ company to revive and to be profitable again? So the answer here is private equity funds. Now moving on to the next question for today. Now the question says the Insurance and Development Authority of India is an autonomous statutory body tasked with regulating and promoting the insurance and reinsurance industries in India. Recently, it has announced various norms for betterment of the ultimate beneficiary, that is policyholders. Choose the correct from the below statements. So three statements have been given to you, and among these three statements you have to tell me that which of the following is correct. The first says that it has made it mandatory for all insurers by December 1, 2019 to provide benefit illustrations to policyholders at two rates, that is 5% and 8%. The second one says that insurers have to ensure that advertisements of insurance products are clear and they do not convey a fabricated sense of security to prospective customers. And the third one says a joint working group of IRDAI and NHA has proposed a unique common hospital registry, empanelment process, grading of hospitals, and package cost harmonization to promote standardization and effective utilization of healthcare infrastructure under the insurance program. Now, let's discuss all of the three statements in the next slide so as to be in a better position to answer this question. So IRDAI has made it mandatory for the issuers to provide policyholders customized benefit illustrations. Now, why is this so? To increase the transparency and curb the mis-selling of life insurance policies. So it has to be done on two different assumed rates of return. So from December 1, 2019, this will be mandatory, and the insurers will provide policyholders the customized benefit illustrations that project their accumulated corpus at the gross investment returns of 4% and 8% for each policy. That is, there will be two investment growth scenarios projected for each policy. Currently, the gross investment returns are 4% and 8% per annum. Now, the second one is that IRDAI has prescribed do's and don'ts for the insurance companies to comply with. So what does that mean? That all the insurance advertisements should ensure that communications are clear, fair, and not misleading, whatever be the mode of communication. The guaranteed portion and the non-guaranteed portion should be clearly mentioned, and the terms and conditions should be explicitly mentioned in case of the digital sales rather than to hide it behind the hyperlinks. Then the last one is a joint working group of Insurance Regulatory and Development Authority and National Health Authority has proposed a unique common registry, empanelment process, grading of hospitals, and package cost harmonization. Also, the standard grading system for hospitals based on the quality parameters should be prepared, and the same grading then can be used by Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana. The same committee has also recommended a single unique hospital registration process, and that repository was known as Rohini, which means Registry of Hospitals in Network of Insurance. So this list is beneficial as a central health facility repository number can be used by various schemes and insurance service providers for identification of the health facilities in the geographical areas. So what is the goal of this repository? To bring all the hospitals under a common hospital registry in the country. Now moving back to the question to answer it. So we have discussed all these three statements and we have noticed that the rates here are 4% and 8% and not 5% and 8%. So our correct answer would be option C, that is 2 and 3. Now moving on to the next question for today. The question says RBI has made some changes in the activities of the banks to benefit the ultimate beneficiary. Which of the following activities has been changed by RBI? First statement is that it has made mandatory for the banks to link floating rate loans to micro and small enterprise loans to buy homes, vehicles, and for personal consumption to an external benchmark rate. Second is RBI has banned the use of direct selling agents to source retail loans and carry out physical verification of the documents of borrowers. And the last one says that RBI has mandated NBFCs to link their loans to the external benchmark rate. Now, I hope that you all know that what external benchmark rate is. And if you do not know, then I have made a video on this. And in fact, the interest rate evolution from the PLR to MCLR to external benchmark now. So you must watch it if you want to have any clarifications on the same. Now, moving on to the next slide to have a better understanding of these statements. So we all know that RBI has mandated the banks to link their floating rate loans, home loans, auto loans to the external benchmark from October 1, 2019. So that statement was correct. The second statement said about the direct selling agents. So let's have a discussion on this. So RBI recently has banned the use of direct selling agents to source retail loans and carry out physical verification of documents of the borrowers. So you must have noticed that some of the agents come to your home so that you could purchase their loans or the credit cards. So RBI has put a ban on those direct selling agents. And the reason is that to reduce the incidence of data theft and minimize operational risk for banks, because while purchasing the loans or the credit cards, we often used to give them the details of our documents, and that is why there were cases of data theft or the fraudulent activities by them. So what happened is most of the consumer retail loans are sold by these direct selling agents. So because of the ban, now banks fear the slowdown in the consumer credit growth. One option is that the agents hired by the banks and business correspondents may carry out eKYC or physically carry a biometric reader to a customer's residence for identity verification. But then bankers believe that equipping lakhs of DSAs with readers and connectivity cannot happen overnight. But RBI is on its stance that the issue of allowing the business correspondents to carry out certification has been examined in detail in consultation with various stakeholders. And in view of the perceived risk that emanates from allowing personal other than the authorized official of the regulated entity for carrying out the certification of officially valid documents or OVDs, so it is of the opinion that the certification shall continue to be carried out by the authorized officials. And what authorized officials means? It means the bank employees. Now, I hope that you have been following the news for the preparation of your examination. So I want to ask all of you one question. Suppose there is a person and he does not have permanent address in Delhi, but he wants to open up an account in Delhi. That is, suppose he is a migrant worker. So is that possible for him to do so or not? So do answer this question in the comment section below. Now, moving back to the question, here the first statement is correct. The second statement is also correct, but the third statement that RBI has mandated NBFCs to link their loans to external benchmark rate is not correct, because NBFCs are still on PLR and RBI is finding ways to improve this situation. It has still not mandated the NBFCs to link their loans to the external benchmark rate. So the correct answer is option B, that is 1 and 2. Now moving on to the next question for today. The question is, which of the following entity has set up the National Equity Fund Scheme, which provides the equity type assistance to entrepreneurs for setting up new projects, which can be classified as SSI units? So the correct answer is SEBI, option A. Now we will be discussing about the National Equity Fund Scheme in the next slide. So what is the objective of this scheme? The objective is very clear: to empower the SSI units and thereby improving their acceptability for team financing by primary lending. Now, these are the eligible institutions from where the assistance can be obtained. The first is state financial corporations. Then we have the twin function industrial development corporation. Then we have scheduled commercial banks and select urban, and then the state cooperative banks. In case of new project, including the margin money for the working capital should not exceed rupees 50 lakhs. And what will be the nature of assistance? The equity type of assistance in the form of soft loans. This means favorable to the borrower. So in short, what happens is the entrepreneurs of these SSI units can file an application while requesting for the term loan assistance from these eligible institutions, and they can also specify the amount of the National Equity Fund assistance in their financing proposal. Now, after discussing this scheme, let's move on to the last question for today. The last question says that working capital management involves financing and management of. So the correct answer here is all current assets. Why not all assets? Because it includes current assets as well as fixed assets. And these are a type of current assets. Now, what does working capital means? It means it is that capital which can be used by a business in its day-to-day trading operations. And how is it calculated? It is calculated by current assets minus current liabilities. Now, working capital management can be of two types, that is temporary and permanent working capital. Now, what is the difference? This is the minimum and the required mandatory portion of the working capital, and this is the permanent working capital which has to be maintained by a business during its operation. Now, over and above this permanent working capital, this is the temporary working capital. Now, with this, we have completed 5 questions of finance for today. I hope that you like this session. Do like and comment on the video. If you like my video, then do subscribe to our channel for more regular updates. And do not forget to answer the question related to the migrant workers that I have asked. Thank you for watching the video.